thee we come, O Lord our God. Jesus resurrects, 40 days later he ascends, and as he ascends into the heavens, he promises to share the Holy Spirit with the church. That happens today, 50th day, Pentecost after Easter. And so that's the symbolism of the red. It says in the Acts of the Apostles, as we will hear a short while later, that tongues as a fire came down upon that first community of believers, and so therefore red is the color of Pentecost. And so gathered today, it's one of the most important feast days of the church. And also, as you came into church, you may have noticed there's a little bit of a mess on the front stairs. We have extra guests that are coming to Holy Name. And right above, as you exit church, you can look, there's like a little window. And in the little window, we have a bird's nest. And so the birds are starting to make a nest up there, and that's that mesh you see on the front step. But it looks cute. Yesterday, a lot of bunch of us were outside, and we did a little bit more of the edible landscapes. You can go take a look out there. And we started to define an area that would be enclosed. We hope to someday get like a little bench. It'd be like a prayer meditation area. All of the trees out there, the apple trees, the cherry trees, they're all blooming. And I think it's going to be really, really nice in a few years. And so I do thank everybody who came out yesterday to help with that project. So as we do gather today for this Feast of Pentecost Mass, I ask you to please make a private examination of your conscience. And may we now recite the Confiteor together. I confess to Almighty God, one in the Holy Trinity, who knows the innermost secrets of my heart, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my own great fault. In your presence, O God, I earnestly repent of all my wrongdoings and am heartily sorry I have offended you. Most merciful Father, have mercy on me, forgive me and pardon me my sins. I resolve to amend my life, improve and sanctify, that I may become worthy to serve you faithfully all the days of my life. I beseech you, blessed Mother Mary, all the saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, pray to the Lord our God for me. May Almighty God have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life everlasting. May the Almighty and merciful Lord grant us pardon, absolution, and the remission of our sins.
Amen.
May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and by his authority vested in me, I absolve you of your sins, in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
O God, you will again renew us.
Show
us, O Lord, your mercy. O Lord, hear our prayer. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Take away from us our iniquities, we beseech you, O Lord, that pure hearts may enter into the tabernacle of the Holy of Holies, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
For the Spirit of the Lord fills the world, is all-embracing, and knows what people say. Alleluia. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. Glory to God in the highest,
and peace to the people on earth.
Lord God, heavenly King, Almighty God and Father,
we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory.
Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father,
Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father.
Receive our prayer, for you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, and the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. Holy Spirit, the giver of life, proceeds from the Father, have mercy upon us. As you descended upon the earliest church in Jerusalem, so now once again, descend upon your church today. Inflame our hearts, enlighten our minds, and purify our souls. For together with the Father and the Son, you live and reign, one God, forever and ever.
The lesson prescribed by the Church for this morning's Holy Mass is taken from the Acts of the Apostles. When the day of Pentecost came, it found them gathered in one place. Suddenly, from up in the sky, there came a noise like a strong driving wind, which was heard all throughout the house where they were seated. Tongues as of fire appeared, which parted and came to rest on each of them, all filled with the Holy Spirit. They began to express themselves in foreign tongues and make bold proclamations as the Spirit prompted them. Staying in Jerusalem at the time were devout Jews of every nation under heaven. These heard the sound and assembled in a large crowd. They were much confused because each one of them heard these men speaking in their own language. The whole occurrence astonished them. They asked in utter amazement, "Are not all these men who are speaking Galileans? How is it that each of us hears them in their native tongue? We are Parthians, Medes, and Elamites. We live in Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, in the provinces of Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, in the regions of Libya around Cyrene. There are even visitors from Rome. All Jews, or those who have come over to Jerusalem, Cretans and Arabs too. Yet each of us hear them speaking in his own native tongue about the marvels God had accomplished." Here ends the lesson prescribed by the Church for this morning's Holy Mass.
Thanks be to God. Therefore, wait for me, says the Lord, for then I will change and purify the lips of the peoples. Hallelujah. Come, Holy Spirit, come, and from your celestial home shed a ray of light divine. Come, Father of the poor, come, source of all our store. Come within our bosom shine. You of comforters the best. You the soul's most welcome guest. Sweet refreshment here below. In our labor, rest most sweet. Grateful coolness in the heat. Solace in the midst of woe. O most blessed light divine, shine within these hearts of yours and our most innermost being fill. Where you are not, we have none. Nothing good in deed or thought. Nothing free from the taint of ill. Heal our wounds, our strength renew, on our dryness pour your dew. Wash the stains of guilt away, bend the stubborn heart and will, melt the frozen, warm the chill, guide the steps that go astray. On the faithful who adore and confess you evermore, in your sevenfold gift descend. Give them virtue, sure reward. Give them your salvation, Lord. Give them joys that never end. Amen. Alleluia. 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 I will pour out my spirit upon all humankind. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions.
Alleluia.
Almighty and eternal God, you cleanse the lips of the prophet Isaiah with a burning coal. Cleanse my heart and my lips through your gracious mercy, that I may worthily proclaim your holy gospel through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be in my heart and on my lips, that I may worthily proclaim his holy gospel. Amen. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the doors were locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in their midst, and he said unto them, Peace be with you. And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said to them again, Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you. And when he had said this, he breathed on them, and he said to them, Receive the Holy Spirit. Whose sins you forgive are forgiven, whose sins you retain, they are retained. By the words of this holy gospel, may our sins be forgiven. If you're on the electronic email list for the parish, or if you've been checking the website or anything, I did extend an invitation to any and all of you to bring a Bible to church today, because I'm going to try a little something different on Pentecost Sunday. If you didn't get any of those notes, or if you forgot, there are Bibles up here. Don't be bashful. You know, you can come up and grab a Bible, because I think this is only going to make sense if you can actually follow along with me. So if you got Bibles, great. If you don't, anybody want to come forward? You bunch of cowards. Come on, grab a Bible. You need a Bible if you don't have one. Come get a Bible. Don't be bashful. Bibles, honest to gosh, they don't bite you. I know a lot of people are afraid of that book, but one brave soul? That means everybody else has got your Bibles, right? All right. All right, I see a judge out there. You don't want to be lying. Now you got your... All right, I don't see any Bibles floating around. Okay, all right. So anyway... We are in the book of the Acts of the Apostles. And if you're not really too familiar with the way the Bible works, the Acts of the Apostles can be towards the back of the Bible if you're looking for it. You got the first four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and then the Acts of the Apostles. So you hear the story of Jesus, then you hear the story of the earliest church. And so you want to go to Acts chapter 1. That's where you can start, or we can start. And so in Acts chapter 1, you get the story of the ascension, which we just talked about 10 days ago. And we came to church and we talked about the fact that Jesus was assumed up into the heavens, and the disciples are sitting there watching him, and they don't know what to do. And so Jesus says, "Don't worry, you're not going to be alone. I'm going to be gone up to heaven, and I'm going where the Father will descend in my name, the Holy Spirit." And that's today, Pentecost. And so Pentecost is that idea that the Spirit enlivens the church. You know, whatever other kind of group you belong to, that group is what you see. But the church is not just us. The church is God leading us. And so when you see, you know, the idea of Pentecost, this is the birthday of the church. It is us beginning to do the work that Jesus in his earthly life once did. And so that begins our journey as church. And the thing is that because the Spirit dwells with us now, that means we are as much church today as that church in Jerusalem was 2,000 years ago. We're not a history class when we come here. We're not talking about what the church was. We're talking about what the church is. And it's always in the present tense because the Spirit is always here amongst us. And so the Holy Spirit comes down upon the community. That is our birthday. One Christian pastor has said that worship is simply giving God his breath back. I love that. You know, in the book of Genesis, God breathes into us, and all of a sudden, human life appears. At Pentecost, or as we just read from the story of John's Gospel, Jesus breathes on them, and we receive the Holy Spirit. When we worship God, we give him his breath back. So if you come to church and treat it as a museum where you're really quiet and, you know, really so respectful that you're afraid to even breathe, well, you're choking God. You know, he wants to, you give him his breath back by the breath that we give him in worship. So don't be so afraid of church. Don't be so afraid of that book. Don't be so afraid of the Spirit. And so with all of that said, without trying to asphyxiate God by just being so scared of everything church, Acts chapter 1, verse 15 is the first verse I'd like you to take a look at. So I hope you all got those Bibles out. I hope you found the Acts of the Apostles. Chapter 1, verse 15 says, "In those days, Peter stood up among the believers. Together, the crowd numbered about 120 persons." All right, so now we're talking 50 days, not even 50 days, after Easter. When Jesus goes to the cross, he's begging and borrowing to find anybody who will stand there with him. There's nobody there. Now we're not even talking 50 days after Easter, and somehow we have 120 followers of Jesus. That means that something extraordinary happened. Jesus taught for 3 years. Jesus did miracles for 3 years. When he goes to the cross, at best he's got a handful of followers, a handful of disciples. Now, a few short weeks after Easter, there's 120 people following Jesus, who believe in Jesus. Where did they come from? The only possible explanation is that something extraordinary happened between the cross and these days, it's almost 50th day after Easter, that 120 people came to believe. The only extraordinary thing that we know about is Easter. And so somehow, 3 years worth of ministry, Jesus has a handful of people. Easter comes along, you know, that wondrous story about Jesus coming out from the grave, and sometimes it feels so wondrous that we can't even really believe it. We almost think it's like a fairy tale. But something happened on Easter, because after that point, now we're talking about 120 followers of Jesus. So now we have to keep that in mind. 120 is a big number. It's actually, numbers have meaning in the Bible. And 12 means fullness, completeness, you know, 12 tribes of Israel, 12 apostles and all that. When you take 12 times 10, it means you got a big number. So it doesn't mean that actually that they sat there and counted, like my acolytes would count when you come up for communion. That doesn't mean they counted 120 people. It means that there's a large number of people. So you've got this large number of people that are now followers of Jesus. And if you go to the next chapter, Acts chapter 2, verse 1, "When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place." All right, so concentrate on the word "all." Who does that mean? It's not defined. Jump down to chapter 2, verse 4. "All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability." Again, who are the all? We don't know. a lot of times, you know, you get pictures of, these little icons you can stick in song sheets or bulletins, and it shows, like, you know, these 12 apostles, the Holy Spirit's coming down upon the 12 apostles, and that's all that it is. I don't think that's what all means. And the reason I don't think that's what all means is if you go down a little bit farther in chapter 2, if you go down to verse 17, I'm going to read there, and you can try and follow along. I know all the Bible verses aren't exactly the same with the words, but it says, in the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour my Spirit upon all flesh. All right? All flesh. That means everybody. And then he continues, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my Spirit, and they shall all prophesy. Now, when you put that much time to get that kind of a phrase in there, I don't think all means 12 apostles. I think all is talking about that 120 believers. And they're all in Jerusalem because Pentecost is a Jewish feast. And on Pentecost, they celebrate the giving of the law to Moses. The law is the bedrock of the faith for the Jewish faith. That is what that would be like their tabernacle. That's the center of their faith, the law. On Pentecost, the Christians come in. They're all coming together. All these people in Jerusalem are there because they want to go up to the Jerusalem temple. They want to celebrate the giving of the law. When the Holy Spirit comes down, that's basically telling us that our new bedrock is not the law. Our new bedrock is the Spirit, the life-giving, living, ever-present Spirit of the church. We are not about laws carved in stone that never change. We are about the living, breathing presence of God, the Spirit. When Acts of the Apostles holds off the giving of the Spirit to Pentecost Sunday, the intention is absolutely deliberate. Law is rejected, Spirit is accepted. So all of them, all of that 120, they have now received the Holy Spirit. And then if you can go to chapter 2, verse 4, and then 11 and 13. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Then all the way down to verse 11. I know we're jumping around, so I ask you to grab a Bible. It makes it a lot easier. All right, Cretans and Arabs. In our own languages, we hear them speaking about the deeds of God's power. Verse 13. But others sneered and said, they are filled with new wine. All right, now it gets a little bit confusing. So you've got all of these people speaking, and you've got all of these people from all over the world, as EJ was trying to read all those different names. I always feel bad for the person that's reading on Pentecost. All those different names. You've got people from all over the known Roman Empire world coming to Jerusalem to be there for Pentecost. They all speak different languages. It's like the story of Babel. And so now all of a sudden you've got the differences, the distinctions, the separations because of languages, and all of a sudden it says, everybody hears them speaking in their own native language. And then there's that weird phrase, though, but others thought they only heard drunks talking. Now, if some people hear, and other people are only thinking that they hear the babble of drunks, I don't know if you can pick that up, but we're not talking human language anymore. We're talking about something that makes no sense. For the people who do not receive the Spirit, they're not hearing Greek, they're not hearing Latin, they're not hearing whatever they speak in Crete or in Libya at the time. They're not hearing these languages, they're hearing Babel. And so that becomes really important because it also says, we hear them speaking. So it's not like one apostle speaking to the Greeks, one apostle speaking to the Romans, one apostle speaking to the Africans, one apostle, it's not like that, we hear them speaking. So what we're talking about is that the Spirit comes down. He gives them all the gift of this foreign language that is what the church will eventually call tongues. And some people can understand the gift of tongues. They can hear what they're saying. And other people can't. And so we don't know what the distinction is. We don't know why. Some are blessed with being able to receive the Spirit and some are not. But the idea is that all those people out there in the streets of Jerusalem, they are not yet Christians. They are not believers in Jesus. They are there because of the Jewish feast of Pentecost. So when the Holy Spirit comes down, inspires the Christians to speak, they leave their locked rooms, they go out into the street, they start proclaiming Jesus. All of a sudden, some of these non-Christians, they're blessed with the presence of the Holy Spirit, and others aren't. But that tells us a very important lesson. It means that the Spirit is not locked within the church. The church does not put the Spirit in a little box and then put it on the shelf and only take the Spirit out when it's convenient. The Spirit is not just us. The Spirit is way beyond us. And it's like he says in Joel, the prophet that was quoted, in the last days it will be, God declares, I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh. Not just believers, but all flesh. And so those people in Jerusalem who did not believe, who were not Christians, all of a sudden, the Spirit changed them. That's an important lesson, because sometimes I think church has this idea that we own God, but God owns us. So it's not that we're the ones who can say what the Spirit can do, what the Spirit can't do. The Spirit is going to surprise us, because the Spirit is not locked in a building. The Spirit is not locked in a certain number of people who are baptized. The Spirit is reaching out to everybody. God insists to be everybody. And so, when you understand the Spirit and the giving it this way, the means that the Spirit comes down upon all people, and some people can take it and speak, others can take it and hear, but we're going to keep reading in Acts, you hear all of these different gifts, all these different ministries, that's all from the Spirit. And the fact that it's not limited to the church absolutely amazes me. And when the Spirit comes down, we've made everything, you know, kind of nice and tidy and quiet and deep. Well, when the Holy Spirit comes down, the word is it's a violent wind. Violent is only used one other time in the New Testament. It's not a very popular word. You know, you don't usually associate violent with Christianity, but this is a violent wind. Think hurricane, think tornado. This is not a nice, gentle summer breeze. This is something that's scary. When you talk about fire, fire is a theophany. It's the image of God that simply can't be controlled. You know, the ancients couldn't control fire. It was something that was, you know, something wasn't physical, it wasn't spiritual. It was just something else that they didn't understand and that conveyed this presence and power of God. So when fire and wind come down upon those first believers, it shook them up, it scared them, inspired them, and they were never the same after that. That's what Pentecost is all about. And so, back in the second century, and this is where I'm going to kind of draw this to a conclusion, there was a bishop in the city of Lyon, which is now France, and he wrote a treatise called Against Heresies. And he said, for where the church is, there is the Spirit of God. And where the Spirit of God is, there is the church in every grace. So wherever the Spirit is, that's church. And the Spirit, according to the Acts of the Apostles, is not defined by church. The Spirit is beyond church. The Spirit is bigger than church. The Spirit is not locked in the little box that the church wants. So if the Spirit reaches out beyond believers, then that means that the church also reaches out beyond believers. The church, in other words, isn't only what we see now. The church is what God wills her to be someday. So the church is always, 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 always a work in progress. The church is being called somewhere by God, and the Spirit knows how to get there. Our job is that we have to let the Spirit lead. We can't try to lead the Spirit. We have to trust in the Spirit's leadership. Sometimes it may not make any sense to us what God is trying to do. Sometimes we may be absolutely baffled by church, by the Spirit, by what we're supposed to do. But that's always been that way, even since the first Pentecost. God is bigger than we are. So let our Pentecost prayer this day be that we let the Spirit fill our souls, fill our church, and also out beyond us to the entire world. And then let's be brave enough and committed enough to follow where the Spirit wants us to go, not where we think we should go. In these things we pray, in Jesus' name, this Pentecost Sunday. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty Lord, on this Pentecost Sunday, we thank you for the gift of your Spirit, always amongst us, always present to inspire us. We ask you, Lord, that we always better try to follow that Spirit. We also pray at this time in memory of Edward Foster on the anniversary of his death, as offered by Mariana and Richard Foster. We offer our prayers also for Johnny Willard, the mother of Cheryl Sanderson, the grandmother of Emily Sanderson, who passed away just this past Friday, is offered by Marge Sanderson and family. We also offer our prayers for Sophia Bosch, the mother of Father Henry Bosch, who died just this past week in Poland. We ask that she may rest in peace, and we also ask that your gift of peace may be shared with her family here and also over in Europe. We also continue to pray for the following, all battling cancer: Doug Robinson by daughter Jenny Whitman and Karen Herzig, Tom Heidel by Teresa Belial, Meg Connors by Ellen and Don Skrosky, Brandy Clemens by her grandmother Dottie Verona, fathers Ray Drada, Jan Gielczek, and Maurice Lazell is offered by myself, and also Frank Skrosky, diagnosed with a neurological disease, is offered by his twin brother Don, Skrosky, Gates, and Kirk McDonald families. Are there any prayers from the congregation? Okay. So Lord, we ask you to hear all of these prayers, plus the private ones that are before you at this time. We ask you to bless all of us here gathered, also be with those of our parish who are unable to be with us here today, and those of our parish who have chosen not to be with us here today. And for these things together, Lord, we pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord. May they rest in peace. May the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things are made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake, he was crucified on Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in fulfillment of the scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism. Forgiveness of sins. I love the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. When the Advocate comes, whom I will send from the Father, the Spirit of truth that proceeds from the Father, he will not speak on his own. He will take from what is mine, and he will give it to you. Alleluia. We receive from your most sacred hand, most gracious Father, the sacramental bread, the same faith and trust to the apostles and disciples of your Son, our Savior. What he said to them, I will be ready to come down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever. The bread that will give you life.
Thank you.
Receive, O Holy Trinity, this offering, which we make to you in memory of the Passion, Resurrection, and Ascension of our Lord Jesus Christ, in honor of Blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints, that may be available to their honor and to our salvation. May they intercede for us in heaven, whose memory we celebrate on earth, through the same Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be accepted to God, the Father Almighty. Amen. Holy Spirit, the Comforter, the Advocate, sanctify these our gifts. Guide us in truth, defend us from evil, and enrich us with your grace. For together with the Father and the Son, you live and reign, one God.
Throughout all ages of ages, ever-living God, we do well always and everywhere to give you thanks, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. After his glorious ascension, to govern, sanctify, and regenerate the Church, to confirm her in truth, inflame her in love, and strengthen her in unity, he took his place at your right hand, and sent us the Holy Spirit, that by the power of that same Holy Spirit, the good news of immortality may resound throughout all the world. Therefore, the angels and archangels, with all the saints and the entire Church, we lift our hymn of praise to your glory, repeating unceasingly.
Holy, 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 Lord God, and your earth, and your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
We therefore, most merciful Father, with saying Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, most humbly beseech you to bless these gifts, these presents, these holy unspotted sacrifices, which your holy Church receives from you, imploring you to defend and guide her throughout the world, together with her priests and all true believers of the holy faith. Remember, O Lord, your servants and your handmaidens. All present in this congregation, imbued with faith in your holy care, your rule, and fatherly love, wholeheartedly this day, we unite in spirit with all of those. We give the most blessed Mary, Mother of Jesus Christ, likewise his apostles, with all the innumerable hosts of martyrs and confessors who lived, labored, and suffered for the same holy cause which Jesus Christ sacrificed his life and his most precious blood, just as they believed, professed, and united with you through prayer and this immaculate oblation, which you have instituted from the beginning of the world, and in time have fulfilled through Jesus Christ, and gave it to humanity as a pledge of eternal salvation. So we too this day profess and unite ourselves with you, most gracious Father, in humbleness of spirit, and accept from your hands this holy bread and this precious chalice as a longed-for gift bestowed on us by the Savior of the world as spiritual food and drink. He promised us this food and drink in that moment when he revealed his divine power by the multiplication of bread and feeding with it a hungry multitude of people, and afterwards foretold the giving of it to his disciples and friends as for excellent nourishment when he said, "It is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever. The bread that I'll give for the life of the world is my flesh." And afterwards, when the temporal and messianic life of the divine teacher and giver of the covenant was drawing to a close, he gathered into the upper room all those whom he had loved in a singular way and had chosen to continue his work of salvation. He spoke to them words of deep love, longing, and resolve. "I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. In the world you will face persecution, but take courage. I have conquered the world. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. Those who love me will keep my word, and my Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. For their sakes, I sanctify myself, so that they also may be sanctified in truth, that they all may be one. As you, Father, are in me, and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I in them, and you in me, that they may become completely one. I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. After these and other words of the Archangel's prayer, and with holy fervor, our Savior took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and having lifted his eyes to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, all of you take and eat of this, for this is my body. In like manner after supper, taking also this excellent chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again giving thanks to you, he blessed it and gave it to his disciples, saying, all of you take and drink of this, for this is the chalice of my blood, of the new and eternal testament, the mystery of faith, which for you and for many shall be shed for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you shall do these things, do them in remembrance of me. Wherefore, mindful, Lord, we your servants, as also your faithful people, in remembrance of this Christ, your Son and our Lord, as also his blessed passion, resurrection, and his glorious ascension, we receive from your own gifts and presents a pure offering, a holy offering, an immaculate offering, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of eternal salvation. These gifts we receive with a joyful countenance, as from him who is the giver of all temporal and eternal good gifts, with an unshakable faith that they will become for our souls saving remedy. We humbly beseech you, Almighty God, and demand that our prayers be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your highest altar for the countenance of your divine majesty. That as many of us as receive this altar to the most sacred body and blood of your Son may be filled with every blessing and grace through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be mindful also, Lord, of your servants and handmaidens, all who have gone before us with the sign of faith, and who have passed on to eternity. To these souls, O Lord, as also to those who have died in Christ, grant everlasting life, and to those who are in life straight in the path of righteousness, unmindful of your fatherly love, mercifully shorten their sufferings, we beseech you, in the name of Christ our Lord and your beloved Son. And grant us, your sinful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part in fellowship with your holy apostles, martyrs, and all your saints, who shed their blood for your name's sake, whose hearts were always open to justice and mercy, and whose lives, patterned after the divine master, merited eternal bliss. Number us, O Lord, in their company, with confidence we ask you, not because of our merits, but that you bestow forgiveness through Christ our Lord, by whom, O Lord, these gifts you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, and bestow upon us all these good things. Through him, and with him, and in him, is to you, God, the Father Almighty, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and all glory. Throughout all ages of ages,
amen.
Let us pray, admonished by salutary precepts and following divine institution, we make bold to say,
past, present, and future, and when you deem it necessary to test us, grant us the same serenity of spirit which you bestowed on the mother of our Lord Jesus Christ, the blessed apostles, martyrs, and all of those who resolutely marched under the banner of our Savior, that being supported by your help, may always be free from sin and secure from all despair. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, ever one God. Throughout all ages of ages, may the peace of the Lord be always with you. May the union of your divine spirit with humanity in Jesus Christ be to our sanctification and life everlasting. Amen. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, grant us peace. O Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, my peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not upon our sins, but upon the faith of your church, and grant her peace and unity according to your will, who lives and reigns, God, world without end. Amen. O Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, who according to the will of the Father, through the cooperation of the Holy Spirit, has by your death revived the world, deliver me by this your most sacred body and blood from all my iniquities and from every evil, and grant that I may always fulfill your holy will, who lives and reigns for all ages. Amen. Partaking of your body, O Lord Jesus Christ, which I, all unworthy, dare to receive, may it not serve as a judgment, but through your mercy may become a defense of my soul and body and a desired remedy. May this sacramental union with you, Jesus Christ, my Master and Savior, awaken in me living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy longing. May it make me a willing and zealous servant toward fulfilling God's purpose on earth, and may it at last unite each other with you, O Christ and God, in eternity. Grant this who lives and reigns with God the Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, world without end. Amen. I will take the heavenly bread, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my heart, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my heart, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy you should enter into my heart, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body of our Lord Jesus Christ preserve my soul unto life everlasting. Amen. What shall I return unto the Lord for all the grace that he has rendered unto me? I will take the chalice of salvation, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. With high praise will I call upon the Lord, and I shall be saved from all my enemies. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ preserve my soul unto life everlasting. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy you should enter into my heart, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy you should enter into my heart, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy you should enter into my heart, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Peace and blessings from God, the Father, the Spirit, and the Holy Spirit, and the Lord. Body of Christ. Peace and blessings from God, the Father, the Spirit, and the Holy Spirit, and the Lord. Body of the blood of Christ. Body of the blood of Christ. Body of the blood of Christ. Body and 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 the blood of Christ. The 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 body and the blood of Christ. Body and the blood of Christ. The 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 body and the blood of Christ. Thank you. your Spirit, they are created, and you renew the face of all the earth. Hallelujah. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Holy Spirit, our Comforter, through this holy word and holy Eucharist, grant us a new vision and a new counsel, new wisdom and fresh understanding, the revival of our piety and the renewal of our fortitude, so that we may go forth from this place, ever faithful in service and fruitful in deed. Establish us in the knowledge of God and also the reverence of the Lord, that we may see the kingdom of heaven here upon earth. For together with the Father and the Son, you live and reign, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Oh, the sacrifice is offered. May the tribute of our worship be pleasing to you, O Holy Trinity, and grant that the sacrifice which I, though unworthy, have offered up in the sight of your majesty be acceptable unto you, and through your mercy be effective for myself and all of those for whom I have offered it, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
May the Almighty and merciful God bless you. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.